Hello again, welcome to another video. Bin fans and casual viewers alike. So four of us in the vehicle today, so two loaders as usual, myself, and then we've got a spare loader because I believe we are suitably well staffed currently. So welcome aboard. I know there's no script, there's no jump cut in, just drive out, talk as thoughts occur to me, get the job done. Main road then please, sir. So as new subscribers, fans and other viewers have requested, black bins today, domestic round, Chelmsford, Essex. Black bins is non-recyclables. We shall see about that later. Two loads today, probably 9-10 ton each. A middling to decent amount of house estates and urban areas, and some countryside scattered work as well. Cool. Always offer a ride. The vehicle's going there anyway. With the black bins, of course, although unlike the previous video where garden waste is very heavy and voluminous, these bins can, and more often than not are, comparatively lighter. However, every house puts it out. So in every single house, we're talking a couple of thousand, 1,500, 2,000 bins a day of black waste. Soon adds up, but cruise about, get it done, staying safe, always. And yeah, get the day done. In my day's work, much like I said in my original video, these people I hold in the utmost, one, two, four, utmost. Their safety is absolutely paramount, no discussion, even if it's to the detriment of other road users. Not dangerously so, if it means they've got to wait or I've got to block a road, that's hard toffee. Real feel that bin. So when my colleague there shouted side waste, Air Council operates in a no extra policy. So a bin, lid shut, nothing on the floor. I don't know where this entitlement complex where people just dump rubbish hither and thither with gay abandon, making a mess all over the streets, increasing the likelihood of vermin, because you have to do it, it's your job. No, it's not. It really isn't. Bins only. We offer unlimited recycling. Unlimited recycling. As much as you want. Multiple sacks, multiple green boxes, all manner of stuff we'll give to you for free as part of your council tax rate. We want zero waste to landfill, ideally. I think that's going to be quite difficult to practice in reality, but we're doing our best in trying to recycle where possible. 102. The reason why I got this clipboard, I'm noting stuff down, neutral, handbrake, is any bins that aren't out, have extras, if it's basically anything untoward or unusual, we got to note it down. So that when the household reports it, there's no cause for complaint or return. If you don't write stuff down, so for instance, if this house wasn't out and I neglected to write the number down, when they go on the internet and report their bin's not been done, whether or not I visited the property, I'll have to go back. If I write it down, I'll do a street name in a minute when I find out what it is. When I write it down, I've seen the address, I've noted there's an issue, no need for return, customer issue. If they've chosen not to put it out, if they've chosen to put waste all upon the floor, that's their problem, theirs alone to deal with. In this local area, where we are now, we are less than a 10-minute drive from a local civic amenity site. And as is often the case with these recycling centres, cars, unlimited waste. You can go in as many times as you want. A van, once, twice a day. But if you're in a car, as much as you want. So when people just dump stuff on the road, expect me to take it, it's not happening. Good foreplan and observation with these people. Brilliant. Super duper. This is, see, unlike my previous video where it was very quiet and I hardly encountered anyone, this road's a bit busier. We want to do this road before school time. Because it's not forbidden, but it's very frowned upon to be doing school zones at opening or closing time because it's just much too dangerous. So now that we're in a real world working situation with other road users, this is gonna be a greater indication of what my day's like. So it's peeping and creeping, gently, gently, gently. If they want to overtake, that's their choice. I don't encourage, I don't wave, I don't induce people to do anything. Unless they're facing straight on and there's only them, myself and them in the situation, that's when I might communicate with people. But ordinarily, people driving past, I'll check the mirror for safety reasons, but I'm not communicating with them, I'm not waving them. Because if that goes wrong and they hit a vehicle, that's my fault. They choose to overtake. If they choose not to indicate, if they don't practice proper observation, or often the case, on their phones, that's their problem. Often the case, try and get the vehicle in a place where it's as close as possible to loader with the minimal walking distance with the bin. Makes the day go a lot quicker and also much more easier for them. They've got more than enough work to be dealing with without me making it difficult by putting the vehicle in an incorrect place. So look, two bins, just clear the safety arms, both bins on, up, 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 up. Done. Offside mirror, near side mirror. Roll forwards a bit. And brake neutral. Let it do its thing. None come from behind. This geezer's gonna have to wait now. He's sodded about in my way. My job's much more important than yours, as arrogant as that may sound. I've got to deal with a couple of thousand people's waste, household mess, real potential environmental issues and contamination and waterborne problems. All manner of waste issues can arise as a result of me not collecting this waste. You're sodding about picking passengers up on the wrong side of the road, facing the wrong way. Well, facing the wrong way, you can wait. So crew safety, absolute paramount. That person in a car with seatbelts and an airbag, they can wait. Duvet, yeah, see, that's quite often a problem when people shove duvets and bedding in the bottom of a bin because of how it compacts and it's not heavy enough. It just lodges up in the bin and won't empty. So look, it's having loads of problems getting in the back of the motor now. But there is no way to safely recycle them, I don't think. Cool. Thank you. quickly noting down a couple that might not necessarily be out. I'm not sure. Mate, he's well walked off ahead pulling them out, so I don't know what is and isn't out today, but I can only write down what I see. So yeah, this is Bin's work. Straightforward enough. Simple. Not about his issues or stress or frustration. 36, 38. Yeah, it's okay. As someone asked me in a previous comment on the original video, where am I going? Because I said that was that the previous video was shot in what I thought was the last day of this job. As a last hurrah and a commemorative piece to immortalise what this job was like. I started a new job. Whew, Jesus. That was a skip hire. Won't do the name, don't do naming and shaming. Might talk about work history later. But yeah, skip hire place in Essex. Really not for me. The way it worked, the operation and the traffic and hazards of the yard and stress. One of the things that particularly filled me with concern and I dare say anxiety each day, you're responsible for all damages. Driveway sinks, you scratch a car, you touch a wall, you bash a post, you are paying cash money for that. That could be thousands. But the risks outweigh the gains. So I didn't stay there very long, unfortunately. So not as if I wasn't capable. Could certainly operate the lift and put the skips where it wanted to go, and the vehicles are much smaller than this. It was like driving a go-kart in comparison, but nah, that job really wasn't for me. Paid a lot better, but not for me. So my driving history. Got on class 2 in 2012, courtesy of RSM in Basildon, which is now Rayleigh, Essex. Good company, would recommend. Unpaid sponsorship. No affiliate program here. Class 2, passed first time with 5 minors. That was about £1,200. Driver's medical, the old D4 form, 50 odd quid. And the initial CPC, so not just the top up of 35 hours, but the full course, and then you've got to do a practical test demonstrating how to check a vehicle over and this, that, and the other. Jesus. That was about another 400 quid. So on the road, we're talking about £1,600 to £1,800, which is not a mean amount of money, but immediate work. You won't be without a job. Particularly now in 2021 with this HGV crisis, where we've got food spaces on the shelves and milk going undelivered and petrol stations claim, well, there's no shortage of fuel, there's a shortage of delivery means drivers. Excuse me. So that was about 1,600 quid. Started off with a national parcel/courier delivery company. Thank you for the start out. That was driving an 18-ton MAN, demountable box body. But they also did 18-ton Mercs, and there's also a 7-ton IV guy. They're all box bodies. No strapping. Everything was either loose on pallets or just cardboard boxes stacked. So I had bulk deliveries of a morning to retailers and industrial areas. And then I had... and also any bulky customer deliveries that van drivers couldn't get on their motor, so like mattresses or big cardboard. One particular delivery is a cardboard box, quite a big old box, like the size of this bench, full of packing kernels, like popcorny polystyrene. And then the afternoon been collections, so that'd be pallets of stuff, bottles of wine, picture frames, and ladders were the main ones that I remember. So every day, same people. So I presume they of course had a contract. So every order they received on their website, we would be the distributors. So I'd go in the lorry, pick it up, take it back to the yard, scan it off, done. Got my redundant from that job. Then I tried general haulage for a while for a company in Essex. Sleeping out, pissing a bottle, pooing a bag. Not quite that bad. I always made sure I went toilet before I went bed. Didn't sleep out that often, but that very much turned me off the idea. Whole fleet of vehicles was curtain side 18 and 26 ton Scanias. I think there was a Mercedes as well, a couple of Arctics. Mine was the only box body vehicle, not demountable. It was just a, I don't think it had a tail lift, it was just an 18 ton box. Renault, good God, what a horrible motor that was. Extremely uncomfortable, steel suspension, no airbags. Crash, crash, bang, bang. That was a 4x4 gearbox. But crucially, because it was a box body, pallets would be very difficult to get on and off. The floor was very warped and uneven. So I'm getting like 800-900 kilo pallets of banana chips off, dry banana chips. Back braking work, really exhausting. Didn't stay there for a couple of months. There we go. Then I went agency work for an agency in Basildon, various clients, general haulage, flatbed work, plant hire, delivery and collection. Hang on, let me concentrate on this first. Go after this one. Yeah, it's a good experience to cut your teeth. Try that for a while, and that's 2013. Then I joined a sheet metal delivery place. Bloody hell, has he made that much progress already? Jesus, he's gone, man. He's on the horizon. Yeah, sheet metal delivery place. Rebar steel as well, but predominantly sheet metal. So like we're talking meter wide, meter and a half, 2 meters long, a mil or two thick. Pretty poor job. London, Hertfordshire, and Essex every day. Pay was okay, but I was treated like dirt. Real poor attitude in that place, dreadful. A lot of bad stories in that place, bad memories. And then 2013 to 14, I came here briefly, back when it was red lorries, not the white ones that we're driving now. Did that for a couple of months, and I went on buses. 2014, I joined for, oh, don't do names. I joined a... Crescent End, 160. Joined buses in 2014, did that for 5 years till 2019. Got my license for them. They put you on a paid course, got paid whilst training. Yeah, did that 5 years, double deckers, single deckers, country routes, urban areas, in between towns using dual carriageways in Essex. With buses, very straightforward job in my opinion. Cruise about, that's it. Basically, open the doors, deploy the ramp, cruise about. But the problems arise with, unfortunately, arguments, hassle, grief, other road users. And the hours, good God. I say, so they operate, well, primarily, unless you found someone to swap with or you went on a certain rota, earlies and lates. So, any five out of seven. So 1 week you're finishing at midnight, 1 a.m, and then with like 1, maybe 2 days rest, you'll be on early, starting at 4:30. So yeah, the old body clock did take a significant knock. Paid all right. I'd bung in all the overtime I could. I worked days off. I was on a split shift pattern, so 12, 13 hour day with a 3-4 hour break in the middle. So I would grab a bit of overtime in the middle, top up their wages, basically you're paid for the whole time you're there. But yeah, the working hours and the stress and the frustration of it, wasn't tenable for the rest of my life. Then 2019, came back here, done various rounds and routes and different permutations of the job. Got itchy feet at times, so I'd leave, got my class one, £1,200, RSM Basildon. At this point they're based in Rayleigh. 1,200 quid for class one, 1,295. I opted for a 5-day course So 4 day training, 1 day test. For the sake, I think it was either a similar amount of money or like an extra 100 quid. For the extra 1 day's training, I'd recommend, because if you go into that test ill-prepared and with, oh, I could have done a few more hours, it's a fool's errand. You may as well have just paid a bit more initially and then succinct. I got everything done, bang, first time, super duper. Got my class one, did that for a couple of weeks, did night work for another local national courier business. That was night work doing trunking. So I'm a fifth wheel trailer, pick up and drop off, or wagon and drag A-frames. So a rigid draw unit with a drawbar, but the trailer had an A-frame which also articulated. So although the trailer followed the unit, reversing it, Jesus, it's the opposite of the opposite of the opposite. Horrible things. Came back here, tried different rounds, different people, got itchy feet again. Paid 700 quid for my high ab. Yo, do it now? Yeah, may as well. I've got my driving past work. That road we started on, What is it called? Sand and something, I imagine?
Yeah, I think it is.
The school lane or sand and lane? Sand and road. So it's not urgent, we do it later.
We'll do it later.
This is Malden Road behind us, isn't it?
I believe so.
Okay. I'd rather forget matey sorted. So man, it's no urgency. Now, due to my super duper observation, I've just seen a vehicle driving right to left there. We assume they're gonna go clockwise, but I'm fully prepared for them to arrive there.
Malden Road is the one you're talking about.
Thank you, I did think it was the case.
And
school or sand or something.
Yeah.
If not, I say, we'll deal with it later. It's not urgent. We'll cruise. Whoa, Jesus.
Yeah,
I can wait. It's all good. Three. Awfully. He'll sort these ones behind. Would you mind? I should be able to make that swing, but might need to shift them back, please.
No worries.
Thank you, sir. There you go. There's our mate. Told ya. Yeah, there's our mate. Oh, a taxi as well. Very fancy. So, yeah, paid 700 quid for my high ab with Sigma Studies on the A13 in Basildon. Good cut. Good gaff, nice geezer. Mind the swing, crush zone. There we go. Yeah, pay 700 quid for higher. I've got above 20 ton, is it, ticket? Unlimited weight ticket with remote control. And I paid extra to have hook, no, swivel, like the standard butcher's hook looking thing. Brick grab and clamshell for like tipper work slash muck away. Got a job delivering enormous coils of wire on behalf of the electricity board, driving a 26 ton rear steer MAN. Vehicle was fine, job was okay initially, but soon tired of that, especially on one delivery where the crane just died. So I've got an 800-900 kilo coil of copper wire extended on the side of the vehicle. Nothing's working. Legs won't retract. Basically, it was all manner of issues. I had to get on the blower, talk to a technician in Scotland of that company's crane, and he was literally step by step talking about how to retract the item in. Very quickly got that delivery off, then left there. That was a bad day. What's especially annoying about though, there was a forklift on site. Now, yeah, we got the crane, but that takes a long while to deploy and you've got to do risk assessments. Well, if there's a forklift nearby, hello, can we use it? First guy said, no one's trained here to use it. About 20 minutes later, I asked the other person, no, it doesn't work. About an hour later, I saw someone driving past using it. So they fobbed me off, but I was in their warehouse about 3 hours anyway, with a broken crane. So they shouldn't have sodded me about. They left that. did a Christmas at Royal Mail, driving little 7.5 tonners. So delivering their cage work.
Brilliant, might need a shunt or two.
Yeah, doing a Royal Mail cage work. Oh, didn't mean to do the name there. Straightforward enough work, but it's just a Christmas temporary job. Then I went on the sewage for a while for the local water board. So not fresh water, but like brown water. Right, need to reverse back a bit, but need to make sure it's clear. Neutral. Reverse. Yeah, that drop was truly terrible. Back-breaking, exhausting, not to mention filthy. Cool. Just to demonstrate what I'm dealing with every day. That's not too bad. Dealt with worse. Might well see some of it later. Yeah, the sewage job. Credit to the people that do that every day. Good God. Put my hands to my face, remembering it. The smell is not the biggest problem. Actual human feculence, i.e. what you put down a toilet every time you flush, that wasn't the main issue. Main issue was the hours that you would keep. Turn the hazards off now. And the drain, lifting up the drains. So for instance, some of these drains, big every iron steel block things, not sure material made out of. I'm gonna say steel if they're modern, but iron maybe, because they just need to be stronger. Dear God, these things were heavy. We're talking 50, 60, 70 kilos plus at ground level. But these things have been in the ground for what, 20 years? With cars driving all over it. Ugh. Cars driving over it, full of tar, macadam and grit and dirt and dust. These ain't coming up for love or money. You're banging out with sledgehammers, you got this. There was a special tool where you put the keys in the drain cover and you rotate a pair of arms, which put a pair of feet down to deploy it. Feet go down, cover comes up. But that was if only worked if the drain had been loose previously. If this had been really cemented badly in, or the tarmac had been filled in over the years, or you had a job getting them out, then you're plunging, or I've got my jetting, my high pressure water jetting ticket as well. So I can operate that. Yeah, man, dreadful. And then we're back to present day. So early 21, present year, come back here. And apart from the skip hire thing, I've done this. So straightforward enough work if you're willing to put the effort in, but do bear in mind all the weathers, all the locations. Pay ain't stunning, but it's a lifestyle. So 4 day week, set sort of like office hours, 6:30 to 4:30. Overtime if you want it. Yeah, it's pretty straightforward. So walk around, put bins on the back of a vehicle. I've got a driver vehicle. That's pretty much the short and long of it. We operate a tachograph here. If I'm stationary for long enough, give it a second. Should do it. It'll go out. So I'll knock it out of scope because we operate on domestic hours. We don't necessarily have to abide by the EU rules. The EU rules always take precedent in any vehicle operation, but we operate on domestic hours. So if I was to get pulled up and they dipped my card, I'd say, well, I drive for local authority and as such, I will operate on out of scope. That's not to say I don't abide by the rules. Taco goes in at 6:30. Lunch break commences before 12:30. That's unlikely. It's highly unlikely that you'll do the driving hours in any given half. So we've been driving since 6:10 this morning, so nearly an hour now. 13 minutes of driving. Because if you only move the vehicle short distances in these modern vehicles, it doesn't count it as a minute's drive. Older analog vehicles or early digital ones, if you move a meter, bang, that's a minute's drive. So if you're stuck in a ferry queue or in bad traffic, you soon watch your drive time whittle away. Whereas a vehicle like this, say, the vehicle left the yard about an hour, 55 minutes ago, 13 minutes of drive. Drive, brake. Now, yeah, so 4.5 hours drive or 6 hours other work, whichever happens the sooner. I've got to take a break. Mine's going blank. So yeah, it's normally the 6 hour thing we abide by. So as long as we're on lunch before 12:30, you can take a 30-minute break if you're finished before, I think it's 2-3 p.m. If you're finished before a certain length of a day, it doesn't occur to my mind right now. So I haven't got an encyclopedic knowledge of all this stuff. I'll do my best. But I ordinarily do a 45, because then that will ensure that it clears all the driving, all your domestic hour break, work time directive agreement, break requirements, and then you start with the afternoon with as much time as you need to use. Whereas if you take a reduced break, I think you have to get done, I've been told, before 3 p.m. before you have to take another break. Because you took a 30-minute break first, you can't take a 15 after, so you'd have to do another 30. A 1 hour break to get the minimum 45. So it's not worth it. For the sake of an extra 15 minutes, just take the 45-minute break in one hit. Hydration. Yeah, seldom get called up. Home every night. No emails, no phone calls. It's not all over the country, it's very much local area. Yeah, it's all right. There's a reason why I keep coming back. Because it's what I enjoy doing in a perverse way. It's where I feel most comfortable. Make sure they're safe. Cool. And a couple more candidates. How you doing?
I'm going now.
Yeah, righto, right after me. This is day one and we're barely an hour in. Nor do I care. As long as he's not in my way, get our job done.
Crashing into inside extra bones.
Yeah. Could feasibly pull out in this gap, but it's not worth it because I'm only stopping a few metres over there. So, although I've got stuff to get on with, I wouldn't mug people off in that manner. It's dangerous and it's foolhardy as well. I'm about people's safety, especially with the modern world. Everyone's got dash cams now anyway. Not worth it. Creep a bit, we'll make the intention clear, otherwise we're gonna be here all morning. Let's go. Despite being in a near 12-foot-tall, 4-metre, being lorry, big flashy lights all over it, people don't ever expect us to stop. Despite they've been driving on a street where all the bins are out, I quite often get people nearly crash into the back of me because they don't expect me to be stopping, even though I indicate in and out when I'm collecting the bins. People seldom look more than 6 metres ahead of their vehicle, 6 foot ahead of their vehicle. Wise. See, I'll learn the plates. He ain't gonna make it long if he keeps doing silliness like that. It's only because my very forward thinking and good observation that I anticipate silliness like that. That's why you've always got to check upper and lower mirrors, near side and offside, and camera as well where applicable. So, near side, got many candidates. Offside indicator on. I'm rolling. If you want to overtake, that's your game. Just rolling, no throttle. Let the vehicle roll forwards. There you go, told ya. Near side check. Offside still coming out past us. Stop the vehicle for him. Handbrake neutral. empty. Everyone's in a rush to get nowhere. So near side, many vehicles, offside, indicator on, rolling, defensive driving, I'm in front. I've got no requirement to let these people pass, there's no obligation on my part. So I'm creeping, gently. If they want to take that space, they're welcome to, but I'm not inviting them to take it. But equally, if the opportunity's not there, don't put yourself in that position. You wouldn't run down a corridor with a locked door in your face and then try and crash through the thing. So I don't know why people try and overtake when the space ain't available. Something I'm often seeing recently, and well, I suppose all times, but especially recently, is when, due to the way vehicles are situated on a road, people can overtake. First vehicle gets past, vehicles 2, 3, 4 rush through after them, they're relying on the brake lights of the guy in front. They have no clue what's going on ahead, but they just charge on through anyway, and then I've got to stamp on my brakes, even though there's no precedent for me to stop. I a priority, not right of way, that has no rule in the highway code. Priority, no obstructions on my side. I'm proceeding ahead, but yet people pull out into my path and then give me the business. Former colleague, he recognises me. Yeah, so people blindly overtake as well. It's so often the case. So, indicator on, gently. So even now, I'm rolling, I've got a coach coming towards me. I've still got someone trying to overtake. It's every day. But this is quite tame in comparison. I've dealt with much worse things. I've had people on roundabouts overtake anti-clockwise to get past me. So I'm going third exit right, and I've had people go from 6 to the 2 o'clock position like that. Madness. I've had people put all four wheels of a car on a pavement to get past me, as in fully where pedestrians are walking. How you doing? Near side indicator on. I'm not driving away, I'm just rolling forwards. So it's very partial on the throttle, because yeah, I've got live traffic overtaking me, got to keep it safe. If I was in a housing area where there's minimal traffic, yeah, full throttle between the bins, bang, bang, bang. Because this is a live environment with the variable unknown of these people, I can't rely on them to understand what I'm doing. So gently, give them plenty of space to do what they want. They want to overtake, that's their problem. This road up ahead, beside the roundabout, where that postman, yeah, where the postman's just come from, is a reverse up. So what I'm gonna have to do, I'm not keen on this junction, I've had this before, enter the roundabout, very quickly block it off, and reverse up. And the park up there ain't too keen either. But we'll deal with it. So we'll do it when it's suitably quiet and clear and safe. Which is, I don't know, it's busy now, but yeah, it will be fine. So, Amarok neutral. Okay, only if you're sure. Alright, so come on. Mate, he's presumably going to stop the traffic behind, so gently forwards. Near side has disappeared. Camera. Offside. Cool. Child. Clueless. Hands in his pockets, no confidence. So I bring the vehicle to a halt. I'm fully expecting him to cross. Come on. There we go. No acknowledgement, no thanks. It's about right for kids nowadays. Poor manners. Got to keep this rear clear of pedestrians. I had a couple of pedestrians walk across about there yesterday behind my vehicle. Held down the horn. Nothing. No acknowledgement. Fools. I'm in geezer. Handbrake neutral. While pedestrians are boarding. Pedestrians. Passengers. Handbrake back into reverse. So gently. So mind the mirrors on this van. having reversed up here previously, we might have to grab some curb as well, because the parking up here ain't so keen, but we'll figure it out. So a bit of right lock, watch the camera, check the mirror, offside. So get it reasonably close. It gives you more room to play with over there. Straighten up, back at partial throttle. So approach a straight line now, but hedges will be smashing the top of the vehicle in a second. More pedestrian kiddywinks, probably on their phones on TikTok or some nonsense like that. Not concentrating what they're doing. So we'll occupy the middle of the road now. Look up the near side, no one coming behind. Straighten the vehicle up. This road is unusually clear. Normally it's bang, 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 bang. Where all the bins are, there'll be a car, and I'll be smashing the hedge and moving the mirrors about. But yeah, we're doing okay today. Pedestrian with dog, just spotted. And my loader in the high-vis. Looking far ahead, both near, foreground and background. 360 degree vision, got to keep observation at all times. You can't rely on these people to watch what they're doing. Everyone relies on you to do it for them. So if you expect the worst and prepare for that, you won't be disappointed nor surprised. So a colleague's gonna stand to the side because he knows the deal. Get it back a bit more, bit more, bit more, bit more, bit more. There, handbrake, neutral, hazards and fog light off. Every time I engage reverse on a vehicle, rear fog light and hazards on, in addition to the beacons that are on anyway, as much light as possible. I want a saturation of information that people look at that vehicle and go, Jesus, there's a lot going on there. I've got your attention now. With so much lights going on, there's no excuse not to see me. So rear fog light, hazard. I even sometimes put the hopper light on, which is just a bright white pair of LEDs that illuminate the rear of the vehicle. So when you're doing early winter morning starts, you can see the buttons, you can aim the bin easier. It does make a remarkable difference. But yeah, gently, gently reverse. As with all vehicle operations and all things in life, we have many chances to do it correctly, but you only get one chance to do it wrong. So you could do a task for years on end, but with the way you complacent or you stop concentrating or anything like that, that's when it goes wrong. Have there been any missing? Well, I can see what I'm missing. Where's my clipboard?
Behind me. There we go.
So he's got 19. That's 2-3. So 2-1's missing. No, that's definitely not out. So 21. Excuse me. And also another thing with reversing operations, we're fortunate we've got pretty decent cameras on these vehicles. Even though this vehicle's 5 years old, it's on a 16 plate. Camera's decent enough, but there is better quality ones in the fleet. Goal, get out and look. If at any point you're in doubt or uncertain of what's going on behind you, get out and look, handbrake neutral, get out and look behind you. Assess the situation. Assess, plan, act. Doing that will reduce the likelihood of any incidents occurring. So for instance, ordinary lorries, or is it ordinary? Your standard vanilla 18, 26 ton boxes or curtains, home delivery, whatever, they might not have cameras and the mirrors can be a bit archaic in some of them. So yeah, get out and look, G-O-A-L. Yeah. seat belts. This is what I'm talking about every day. At no point did I induce her to come past us, now on the pavement, with pedestrians in the road. Plenty of space behind that motor there, that he managed to work it out. small bips of the horn because way too fast for the situation. Good observation, good forward planning. This is what I was talking about. People don't look what they're doing. Just they see me in large vehicle, gotta get past, gotta get where I'm going, without foresight of what's gonna happen ahead. So to continue as I was saying, the reason why I gave a little beep beep, I've seen something that he's likely not seen yet. Well, I would deem that too fast for the situation, the way that car's driving. So I bipped the horn. That's alert for the loaders, not for the cars. I'm not talking to the cars, I'm only talking to the loaders. Hello, likely to be vehicles nearby. I've seen something you haven't. And it has been a couple of times where that has saved people, where they would have just blasted out. But my beep horn even caught their attention enough that they stopped what they were doing. So I do it again. So he's stationary, passed, done. Courtesy, help each other, team. Way too fast for conditions. She didn't wait at the junction. There was no indication. No, she weren't looking forward. She was looking around her, but not in front of her. I watched all of that occur. And that's the kind of silliness we've got to deal with. Very hazardous job, this. There is a very, Tom Clancy, clear and present danger every day. Because people aren't concentrating what they're doing. It's like they're too incensed. They're fixated. And fixation's dangerous when you're so focused on a goal that you become oblivious to what's around you. So I've got to get to work, I've got to get my kids to school. Oh, I'm late for saying. Not concentrating. They can kill people. Someone's died here. We've had a load of die in this place. It's dangerous, man. It really is a very potentially hazardous job. As long as you practice good observation and forward planning and always allow yourself to look. I went forward more than necessary, but that's to keep the traffic flowing. Good junction cutting. Yeah, give yourself space to operate. So this is what I was talking about earlier, where I would might have to put the vehicle in a place where people have to wait a bit, but load of safety is utmost priority. So I've got two behind, I've got him, they're struggling, but they're gonna have to wait. They've got to wait. We got stuff to do. Again, I'd say that's too quick for conditions. Definitely on the phone, he's talking to someone. Hands-free it may be, but it doesn't necessarily mean he's in control of the vehicle if he's distracted. That's why I let phone calls ring out. If I'm busy driving, I ain't talking. Well ahead of you, thank you. Thank you very much. Good job. smashed out someone's driveway, so we'll grab a bit more of the road.
There we go.
Are we going down there next, or do you want to do Gilmore Way first?
I don't really mind to tell you the truth.
It's your work, man. However you want it to be done. We'll get this dealt with first. Figure out if safe. That, do a loop, then we can exit, yeah. And then this is conclusively done. Otherwise, we've got to go up there, somehow spin around.
Yeah,
and that's the main drag, and it's... Nah, let's go back that way.
Spinking out, we've got to turn around, and it's enough stop time, hasn't it?
Yeah, not happening.
I was thinking as we're coming down, it's not
going to
work.
No. Oh, goody, I get to load some bins. Explanation last time. Manually cycle the crushy blade. Can't see because this vehicle's filthy. Alert bell in the cab, something's going wrong outside. That manually raises the blade, but doesn't scoop it, just gets the blade right to the top, and then you can start scooping down again. Emergency stop. When the vehicle's unloading in the tip, blade pushes all the mess out the back, lower the vehicle, buttons in the cab, it goes down to 1 meter, so it stops about here. Like 1 meter for shutting. And then for the last final bit, you have to press both of these to close the vehicle, and that ram operates. So the vehicle closes, that ram goes down and crushes down. Set of hooks here, ga-donk, and you hear like a loud ga-donk to signify that it's locked in place, ready for road use. Ooh. Before he gets too far down the road, much as I was discussing with my other colleague, if we continue down the road ahead, it'll take us to that fairly busy single carriageway that we started the video off at, which means there'll be a whole mini estate that goes untouched. So we'll do this street and then blast down there. I think it was Gilmore Way, because there's a whole lot of work that needs doing down there as well. There's that Gilmore Way bit, isn't there? There's like another loopy doop up there, isn't there? If we go down there, it's going to be more difficult to turn around than if we just do that, because that's a loop, isn't it? Thank you. Can't that Gilmore Way estate, isn't there an exit that leads to the school?
Yes.
Can that not be accessed from that end? Can't you turn right into it?
Yes, you can. That's what I thought. This one took us to near the big loop.
Yes, you can.
So what would you rather then?
I suppose we could go that way, come round, back on itself and go backwards, can't we?
And then we'd be exiting out the top of there. After that's done, what's the next one? Sorry about that. What's the next one after that?
After that, I think that's a state done.
And then it's the villages and all that,
and
isn't it?
And then it's into like Sandon, scattered bit.
I didn't mean to recall him. If I'd have known, didn't occur to me at the time that could be a direction.
Yeah, we could go backwards.
Okay. Well, hopefully this kills enough time that we're not near the schools.
If we are, then
we'll deal with it. Well, it's not as if we're loading in the schools, and we're driving through it, which is quite permissible. Journey under 50 metres.